Okay. Oh, the red light is on.
Do you want to show Ozzy what it looks like so he knows?
Red light is on.
No. Yes, it is.
Here's what you look like.
Well, I can't see it.
Oh, okay. You're going to have to take your glasses off.
That's fine.
No, you're fine.
That's fine.
You could critique it.
I know what I look like. I mean,
so why don't you tell me about how you and Barbara met?
We met? Well, okay. It was a funny thing. I had just gotten on a shore leave. I'd been on sea duty for 18 months, I guess it was. So they put me ashore in the 1st Naval District in Boston. So I had my 30-day leave, and when I come back, they said, "You're going down to Woods Hole." I said, "Gee, where is that?" So finally they told me where it was down on the Cape. And that was at the end of June. And I was there a week or two getting accustomed to the place, and I found out they were going to have a big 4th of July celebration, a clam bake cookout down at Falmouth Beach. So we went down there, and the cookout was going along fine. And there was a small beach house, which was a public building. And in there was music and girls dancing, and that attracted my attention. There was one young lady that was really doing a good job, so I asked her if we could dance together. And we danced pretty much the rest of the night and had a very enjoyable time. And I borrowed somebody's car, I don't know whose it was, and drove it to where she was staying, bid her good night. And then I saw her a few times afterwards at the base. And I went to one of the USO there, I think in Falmouth, and she was there one night. And we got together and danced quite a bit and had a very nice time. So after that, whenever I had an opportunity to go downtown, I'd more or less say, "Well, I'm going downtown tonight. Well, you're going to go to downtown. Where will you be?" Usually it was over at the Falmouth Inn.
USO?
No, what was the inn? Falmouth Inn, anyway, and we would go there. There was a piano player there, and every time Barbara would walk in, he would play the desert song because that was her favorite. You know? So we danced there for quite a while. Of course, that was the 4th of July, as I say, that we met. And by the end of October, we had decided we were going to get married maybe partway through October. And on October 10th, right? We were married, not November 10th, rather, excuse me. November 10th, we were married. So that was a few years ago, and we've been going strong ever since. So we, of course, enjoyed dancing together, which we did quite often. And as far as the big bands were concerned, when I took her back to Belmont, where I had lived, just outside of Boston, and to meet my mother and my sister and so forth. On those occasions, we would go up to the totem pole. It was usually a weekend, and it was kind of a surprise thing the first night that I took the totem pole because Vaughn Monroe was there, and Vaughn Monroe was one of her favorites because he had the deep baritone voice and sang all the pretty songs. Not much of a band, but he in himself was worthwhile watching. So I would say probably within the next 2 or 3 weeks, we probably went up to the totem pole again, and Tommy Dorsey's band was there. And so we spent that night dancing and watching Tommy Dorsey. And then on a third occasion, which was in probably within from the beginning when we saw Vaughn Monroe to the time that we saw this last band, which was Les Brown's band, was probably less than 3 months, and that those bands were there. And at that time, Les Brown still had Doris Day singing for him. She was 20 years old, I guess, at the time. And I think that was probably within 2 years or so that she made her first movie after we had seen her. But she was very vivacious singing, but a very, and say somebody would be very easy to talk to. So we enjoyed that very much. So we went on and danced quite a bit there. The first 5 years we were married, we had quite an enjoyable time going out to various dances, to sporting events. We used to go to ball games, some football games, so forth. And Then, of course, after 5 years, we had our first child, and things started to change then, so we didn't go out quite as much. We worked a lot harder, took care of the kids, so that's pretty much how.
Do your kids dance?
Pardon?
Do your kids dance?
Actually, there's only one or two that dance. There's not really any of them that get into swing the way we. I have high hopes for a redheaded granddaughter. The redheads really work out well, and she's an excellent dancer. And she can do the swing and she can do the whole bit, so we're very happy about that. The boys are real klutzes. Although Michael, he was at the compact big band dance with us on the February 11th down in Nashua. And he did get up and dance, but it was mainly, you know, one place and turn around, move around. So really wasn't dancing the way his mother and I like to dance. So that was enjoyable.
What is Desert Song? You mentioned it was a song they used to play for Barbara.
The Desert Song was from an operetta, wasn't it, originally?
Yes.
And it...
Well, actually, it's a movie.
Yeah, but you saw it in a movie, but it was from an operetta.
Originally?
Yeah.
The Desert Song.
Yeah, and it was... Well, what would you characterize as a ballad that told a story of the of love and seduction and all that kind of stuff, you know. So she liked that. And then this piano player who's, I almost said it the other day what his name was.
Who, in the Perry, and not in Perry Mill, but in the restaurant where?
Down the Cape, yeah.
Down the Cape.
Yeah. But anyway, he used to play that for her. Now, see, in those times, as far as bands were concerned, now, if you want to go back a bit, you have to remember that there wasn't television. Record players, a lot of them, first you had, of course, you had wind-up, and then you had the electric operator ones. And the sound systems weren't that great, and you didn't have disc jockeys. Somebody had records. I mean, that was a big chore hauling records around with you. But from the days of the 30s, before, and the 20s, every place you would go, they would have music. I can remember going into the Metropolitan Theater, which is the Wang Center now in Boston. And that, of course, was a very ornate place. And went in and had great lobby. It looked like going in into the opera houses, you know, of old. And so they would have a show in there, and it would usually start off with their own orchestra that would come up on a raised platform out of the pit, and they would play an overture. And then the thing would get down, the elevator or whatever it was went down, the floor went down again, and then the stage show would start. Now, there might be another band on there. It could be, I remember seeing Paul Whiteman in there one. And Paul Whiteman might go through his repertoire, and then there might be some other acts along with that. Now, after the show was over, which also included a movie, after that show was over, you could go downstairs, just below in the lobby, go downstairs, and there was a lounge room down there, and at one time they had a small orchestra down there, 6 or 8 pieces, and you could dance down there. You could buy soda or whatever and sit around and listen to the music, and that was all for your 30 cents or whatever else it cost you to get into the Metropolitan at the time. So I had seen a good many bands in there. They booked more of the show type bands. Another one was Fred Waring and his orchestras, Pennsylvanians. And they were a show band, and he had a lot of vocalists. And it was very, very entertaining. So that was my first introduction to live music. Of course, as I say, we used to hear a bit on the radio. And then as I got older, I got to listen more, to appreciate more of the bands. And I would see them when they would come into town. And I would say a band like Benny Goodman, which is best band, was probably the period of 1936 to 1938, to 39, in that period there. That was the best band that he ever had. He was doing a lot of arrangements. Fletcher Henderson, who was someone that played the same kind of music as Benny Goodman did, and he had an all-black orchestra, but it just never became popular. He never got the opportunities to get into the right dance halls and the right theaters. So when he abandoned his band, he went with Benny Goodman, and he was the one who was doing arrangements for Benny Goodman during that time period. And it's also the time when Benny Goodman had his best orchestra, when he still had Harry James with him, Gene Krupa, Lionel Hampton, and Teddy Wilson. And that was fabulous to see those guys when they did the quartet and so forth. And Teddy Wilson, his fingers just fly over the piano keys. And they would have a lot of fun, because a lot of times when the piece that they were playing, when they'd stop it, they'd sort of go, whoo, and laugh, you know, to one another. So it was a lot of fun watching them. So I had probably seen Benny Goodman more times than any other band, and it was certainly my favorite. And of course, how he became famous was, and became known, was through radio programs. And he got his opportunity to play on one of the cigarette companies who sponsored him. He got his opportunity to play on this cigarette program where he was the swing band, and they had another band on there that was the sweet band, which they did quite often in places. They'd have sweet and swing, and well, they would have maybe the band switching on the same dance hall, but there was a unique place in Boston that they used to call the Raymore Playmore, and which was connected by a passageway, and in one ballroom would be a sweet band, and the other ballroom would be a swing band, and fairly well-known bands would come in there. But that's how you got to know your bands, was through the stage shows and through the radio programs. Radio programs, for the national networks, they would sort of, as they do in television, they'd probably take over the early hours up till, say, 9 o'clock. And then after that, all those programs, the comedy programs and the singers, Kate Smith and a few more and like that, would come on for a while. But after 9:30, there would all be bands playing there. I meant to bring with me an old paper I had on the one side. There was a sports thing that I was saving. It was either my brother or I. They had something in the paper about us. But then on the back side, happened to be some radio listing schedule, and you would see that after 9 o'clock was all band remotes from different places. Band remotes was how one of the reasons that Vaughn Monroe became so popular. He was fronting a band for the Newman, Ruby Newman brother, and Ruby Newman and his brother, who had several bands in the Boston area. They were the Society Band, and he was fronting a band at Silas 10 Acres, and they used to do a lot of remotes from there for whatever reason, I don't know, but they used to do quite a few. And he would sometimes be on three times a night, so you would hear him singing away if he was there. I think he was a trumpet player, but I never heard him play it. So. Okay, let's take a break from that.
Tell me.
I told you.
Go back. You covered more than half my questions. Well done.
I told you when I get talking, you'd have a hard time.
That's
you have
perfect.
To shut me up.
I'm going to take you back. Take you back toward how you were telling me about meeting. You did so much dancing. Did you have dancing at your wedding that you had?
Well, the wedding was a small affair. You know, we held it at the club where we danced quite often, and my mother and Barbara's mother came down, my sister, her husband, and my niece, who was about 2 years old, 3 years old at the time, and that was pretty much the size of it. And we financed the wedding ourselves. I think we got a radio was our big thing. The rest, I won't call them the girl, you have to call them the spas, because that's what they call them. They gave you a wedding gown, a wedding,
one,
yeah. All right, they gave you something, and they took you out to dinner, and they had a big time. And I went with the guys, and we were supposed to, you know, have a big party. Drink more, probably a couple more times than usual. But the main thing is, I didn't have to pay for any of the drinks, you know. But that was it. The wedding was a very small affair, and we had rented a a house down on the Falmouth Beach. And that was our first house, first home, if you want to call it that. And that's where we spent our wedding night and our honeymoon and whatever else you want to call it, which I don't think was Sunday. We were back to work on Monday.
You went on, I went on duty and you...
How long did you serve in the Coast Guard? What years were you in the service?
In the service? Mm-hmm. I joined in 1942, and I got out in 1945, so it used to be 3 years, almost December to December both times. And I put, I served aboard a destroyer escort and did convoy duty, Atlantic, Mediterranean, and across the ocean 16 times, so.
Were you a recruit? You weren't drafted, were you?
No, I joined them. I had tried to, actually my first choice was the Army Air Force. I wanted to get in the pilot program, but I had a tough time passing the exam for it because I wasn't very good on mathematics. So for quite a while, they were still given an exam, which was a college level. And another friend of mine, Clarence, there, he went in a second or third time, and he passed it. And I would say that he knew less than I did about mathematics, but he got in. And he did get into the Air Force.
You were telling me that desert song was Barbara's song. Do you and Barbara have a song that you enjoy dancing to?
Well, yeah, it was always a favorite that we danced with for long. It was a particular version of Woodchopper's Ball by Quick Now. It was right on the tip of my tongue.
Yeah, I know it.
Woodchopper's Ball by Woody Herman.
Woody Herman.
I know, it says Wood, I know that. Woody Herman, and there are several versions that he has done or made, depending upon what orchestra or what herd, as he called it, that he had. And this one was a very big band type, whereas some of the other ones that he made were real jazz, and the difference between it, as far as we're concerned, was the real jazz ones, they would hide the melody as they do in a lot of real jazz. You know, they really go off on tangents. And this one was good, real straight. In fact, they use it quite a bit when they try to do the, what's the one they do in a group? When Frankie Manning was here and they did that group dance.
Rueda?
Huh?
Swing Rueda?
No, it wasn't that. That was before. That was the one that John was trying to do. This was another one. And they would do a sort of a group dance. And they would always play Woodchopper's Ball because it fit in very, very nicely to it.
Right? With Frankie Manning?
Yeah.
Oh.
And Woodchopper's Ball, if you listen to the rhythm, it's a real good Lindy beat. It's not too fast, not too slow. It's right in that intermediate level. Actually, to do a good Lindy, you can't do it too fast. If it gets too fast, you got to do something like a Balboa steps or something to it. But to try to execute, as I call it, an open version of a Lindy, where your steps are fairly wide apart and so forth, and there's a lot of intricate foot movements, you just can't do it to the real fast beat. At least I can. But Woodchopper's Ball had a very, very good beat. And we enjoyed that. So we did that, as I say, the dancing there at the totem pole. And other places that we would go, wherever they had any music of any sort. And I can remember going in. We went into Boston one night, and we went into the Hotel Bradford, I guess it was, which was across the street from the why do I miss the name? The Metropolitan Theater. We went there one night, and there was a big band. We played there. And of course, Barbara, after all her big time in the service and everything like being married, and they didn't want to serve her drink because she looked too young. Well, yeah. You know, she wasn't really much bigger than you. If she was any bigger than you, maybe I think she's a little taller, maybe.
Yeah.
And
you were telling us, Ozzy, that your favorite big band leader was probably Benny Goodman. How come?
Well, there again, I had the opportunity to see him so often, so I really enjoyed what he was playing. Plus, I appreciated it to my ear, and of course he had such fabulous musicians with him. And at that time, you had playing the drums. You had Gene Krupa, which was a lot of fun to watch, and of course you had, Lionel Hampton in the quartets and so forth. Lionel Hampton on the vibraharp, and trying to understand as he played that vibraharp and understand what he was trying to say though, or sing, because he always made some real weird sounds as he was playing that. And then, of course, as I said, Teddy Wilson was a joy to watch. And then, of course, Harry James, when they would be playing a piece and the trumpet section would come in, and it would just come in like a gang of chariots coming down, you know, the walls being broken down, and he's blown away on a horn. So it was really something to listen. That was probably one of the better periods of that Harry James ever had, was when he was playing with Benny Goodman. He left Benny Goodman at 38 at the end of the year. And that was after, of course, 38 was the year that Benny Goodman had played at the Carnegie Hall. He played there in the spring. Of course, the orchestra he had at Carnegie Hall was an augmented orchestra. He had players from Duke Ellington's band and from several other bands that set in with them. And so that band wasn't really just the Benny Goodman Orchestra. Because actually, Benny Goodman Orchestra was probably a basic orchestra, never exceeded 15 guys, sometimes with even less. And so, as I say, another thing is, before that orchestra broke up, and I'm not too sure on the year, but I think it was 38, and it might have been the fall of 38, there was a charity event in the Boston Garden, the old Boston Garden, and the big attraction was Benny Goodman. And the other band that appeared there was the aforementioned Rudy Valley, and one of Ruby Newman's bands, and other people whom I have no idea who they were now, I forget. But I know Helen Forrest, for sure, I know was with Benny Goodman at that time, because I remember sitting there. They allowed not only all the seats to be filled, but they allowed the people down on the auditorium floor. And it was the largest crowd that they had ever had in the old Boston Garden. I don't know what the figure was, but I know the seating capacity used to be about 13,000, so there were probably 5,000 or more people beyond that seating capacity was at the hall that night. And the reason I remember Helen Forrest so much is because they had these horses there to sort of seal off the area to give the band stand a little room for the band people there. And as the folks were there on the floor, they kept pressing closer and closer and moving those horses. And she was very, very upset. She thought that, you know, that they were going to get around the bandstand so much they'd probably knock it down. So she was quite upset about the whole thing. But anyway, it was a very enjoyable night, but I remember that was what you would see when you go dancing.
How'd you learn to dance, Ozzy?
How did I learn to dance? Learn to dance, if you were going to be socially active at all, you had to learn to dance. If you wanted to be a klutz and just take your chances, otherwise you didn't learn to dance. First of all, some of the big things when you're in school at the time, as far as social events, were the graduation proms and so forth. And there was always, of course, what they call a junior prom for the senior graduating seniors. But at the school that I went to, they also had another girls' club that was there. It was called the Belmontians. And they had a prom earlier in the spring than the graduation prom. So what would happen, the girl would sort of say, well, now if I invite my friend Ozzy to the Belmontian prom, then he will invite me to the graduation prom. So that sealed it out. She was all set. I mean, for the two proms, you didn't have to worry about a date. So, which worked out to be very good. And also, Ozzy had a brother who had a car, and he had a good chance of getting a car. So that eliminated another problem. Well, these were big things. I mean, today, you know, if you can't get a car here, you can get one there or there. that didn't quite work out there. So a lot of skullduggery went into us to get a ride and so forth, to get a date and so forth and so on. Then, of course, the other thing is I had a job working at grocery stores on Saturdays and maybe Friday nights sometimes, and that little bit of money put me in a good position so that I could have had a fair chance of financing my tux and the flowers for the corsage and so forth. So she made a wise decision with this young lady there to invite me to the dance. So anyway, that's what you would go to, and it was live music. And a little little story there that was kind of funny at the time. As I say, Harry James left the Benny Goodman Orchestra in the end of 38. So in 39, he tried to establish orchestras. Now, Boston seemed to be a good place for bands to be formed and to try out in the area. One of the reasons was that there were many, many ballrooms in the area. In fact, I saw a figure the other day that there was over, at various times, there would be over 100 different ballrooms that would have ads in the papers there in the greater Boston area for the ballrooms. And that included, I'm sure, probably bands, ballrooms within a 50, 75 mile radius. I don't think it probably went any further than that. But that was how many ballrooms there were. So that a band could come up here and they could form the band, and then they could go out and play every night and play in these different little ballrooms, and then get themselves into some sort of shape so that then they could go down to New York and play at a hotel down there, and they would be smooth enough and have had formed what their personality would be so that they would go on. So anyway, that's why the Glenn Miller Orchestra started up here. Artie Shaw used to be up here a lot, bands like that. So anyway, the Harry James Orchestra, they formed it here. So the word came around from the booking agents that Harry, he was available. And so the girls at Belmontians said, well, we're not going to have the usual fellow that comes in and plays all the proms here. We want Harry James. Well, of course, Harry James was going to get considerably more money than the regular fellow was. And the poor teacher that was in charge of the club that monitored the club, she was devastated that the treasury was going to be depleted because these girls wanted to have Harry James. So that went on for a while. It was quite a talk. So we thought for a short period of time that we might have had Harry James playing it at our proms here, or at the Belmontian prom. But it didn't work out the way the cooler heads prevailed, and the teacher was very, very happy that the girls would accept the regular band, so she wouldn't deplete the treasury. But that's the way it went.
So you said anyone who's involved in any social aspect knew how to dance. Did they teach you in school?
No. You learn by dancing with a particular girlfriend, and that would happen in those days. It was a good many of the young ladies lived in homes that had the cellars that had oil burners in them. Now, this made a big difference because you had a oil burner in a cellar, then you had a lot of cellar space. You didn't no longer had the coal bin or anything like that. So they'd make what they call a playroom downstairs in and decorated in various manners. Some of them were very, very nice, almost looked like the upstairs part of the house. So on a Friday night or Saturday night, that's what you do. Some young lady would invite you and your friends down, and she'd invite some of her girlfriends down. So get the record player out and you'd start to dance. So the klutz that didn't know how to dance, they would learn a little bit down that way. So you learned a lot that way. Sometimes just another guy and you would get together and say, gee, I want to go out with this girl. It's going to be a dancer and I want to go to the dance and I want to dance with so-and-so, but gee, I don't know how to dance. Well, this is the way you do it. So the two of you start stumbling around trying to dance. You know. Because at the school, there was a lot of dances after the basketball games. And they had a fairly large record player there that had seemed to have a pretty good speaker on it. And I think they put it on the PA system there, so at least you could hear throughout the gym. And so that was the opportunity that you'd have to dance with the girls there. So you had to learn at least how to do the basic steps. So it was in that form that I learned to dance. Now, the smart guys were the ones that had their mothers that made them go to dancing school. Now, they hated it, and we used to make fun of them, but they learned how to dance, and also the girls were comfortable with them. So then when there was a dance at school, you had these fellas, they would be able to dance with all the girls, and you'd be sitting there, how come that they're doing? Oh, they went to dancing school. Aha. Uh-huh. And a little note that was of interest for you people was, you remember the dance that John had a month or so ago that you know, that we all attended. Do you remember the heavy set fella that had, did he have shorts on that night? The fella from down
from
the Cape?
From Swing City, right? Mm. Yeah, he was there with his wife.
Yeah, because he attended the classes there. You know. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. Get him to tell you about when he was just a young fella in grammar school and how his folks made him go to dancing school down in Fall River. Well, he lived in that area. No, Fall River? New Bedford. New Bedford, he lived down in that area. And so he would tell me one night about how he had to go. And he said, there I was, he said, learning how to dance. And he said, I was very shy. But he said, gee, the one thing about it, he said, there weren't too many fellas there. And he said, when these girls would need a partner, he said, they'd come and dance with you because you're the only fella. He said, I got a chance to dance with all these girls. He said, well, which I never would have had that opportunity even to talk to them. He said, so he said, that's when I learned to dance. Because he and his wife go to dances all the time. You may have seen them down at Swing City. And, of course, they were at St. James Watertown there, the Boston Swing Dance. I've seen them there. So we were very surprised to see them up there at Norwich. So that was fun.
How many of the major big bands did you see?
How many? Well, it'd probably be easier to say them, the ones that I didn't see. And the one that I never saw in person was the Artie Shaw Orchestra. And part of that reason was I just didn't realize when I found out since that he actually did appear in places like Roseland State Ballroom, which was one of the ballrooms in Boston. But I can do remember him coming to Boston and playing in places like I think it was the Ritz Roof, and then there was another one, might have been the Hotel Brunswick or something, and he'd play up there. And there's no way I could get in there, you know. Maybe not. I don't know if I had a full suit at the time. Probably did. But yeah, I did. But I mean, he would be in those places, so I never had an opportunity to see them. But as I say, those aforementioned bands that I saw in the Harry James Orchestra. And then there were other show bands that came into the totem pole. And Johnny Long, which was a show band, and there was another one out of Chicago that came in, and the name escapes me at the time. And then there were fellows like the McFarlane Brothers, who was a local band out of Connecticut, but they toured. And then the bands I'd seen was Glenn Gray, which I have another story to tell about that. And then we did Boyd Rayburn, we did Tommy Tucker, Gene Krupa when he had his orchestra, Eddie Howard when he had his orchestra. Eddie Howard was a vocalist, a crooner more or less, that lived in and appeared in the Chicago area, and he appeared with a number of bands. And during the war, World War II, he formed his own band, and it was just a good touring band because he only had about 8 or 10 pieces in it. And then they had 2 or 3 other fellows who could join him in the vocalist, so they had a little choral group there. And of course, I saw Glenn Miller, and who else did we see? Other big bands. Ina Ray Hutton, you probably never heard. Ina Ray Hutton was the sister of Betty Hutton, who was a vocalist for Glenn Miller. And she had an orchestra and appeared at the totem pole. It wasn't an all-girl orchestra. It was all men in the orchestra. She fronted that one. I tried one time to get in to see Chick Webb, and that was down at a club in Boston, but I didn't have any success at getting in, and they threw me out. And the vocalist was we listened to the other day with Armstrong.
Chick Webb's, was it Ella?
Chick Fitzgerald.
Ella Fitzgerald. She appeared. She was only 18 at the time. And so that was pretty much it, that I'd seen all those bands. Oh, Jimmy Dorsey. We saw Jimmy Dorsey one time. We saw Jimmy Dorsey one time in a theater in New York. And he had one of the Everly Brothers and Helen O'Connell. And they did Green Eyes and a couple others that they were hit records at the time. And Glenn Gray, story about Glenn Gray. After one of the trips I made overseas on a convoy duty, we came back and we came to New York. So they put the ship in the Navy Yard, which was a normal thing to do. There was things that had to be repaired on it. So we had our liberty this day, the group of the fellows, and we used to meet on Sand Street, which was the street coming out of the Navy Yard, and it would be loaded with barrels. So it was one place we would all meet in one of the bars. So what are we going to do tonight, fellas? Oh, well, let's go up to the city. Oh, okay. Gee, I liked a good meal. Oh, one of the fellas said, I know what we ought to do. We ought to wait a little while, and we'll go uptown. We'll go to the Hotel Pennsylvania. They have a nice ballroom there, and they usually have a live band, and the restaurant's nice, and so forth. So we said, good, we will do that. So we trooped up to probably about 12 of us, I guess. And we trooped up to the Hotel Pennsylvania, and we went in there, and we had a very nice dinner. And the band for the evening was the Glenn Gray and the Casaloma Orchestra. Now, of course, Glenn Gray was the orchestra was one of the first, actually, one of the first swing bands. They were known more for their swing band music. But by that time, he had sort of turned into more of a commercial orchestra, and everything was in swing. So he was very acceptable there at the Hotel Pennsylvania. So, of course, it was during wartime. It was very difficult for a band leader to keep his orchestra together because his musicians were being drafted and left and right or being offered better jobs than other bands. So he was there that night. He had the vocalist was Kitty Callan. Beside Kitty, there was a nice little stand. There was a stand there and a nice little sign on it that said, a fixed program, which meant he wasn't accepting any requests. And the reason, of course, was that the band members were good at just playing so many of the songs, and some of them the rest of the book they weren't too sure of. So there was some particular song which I can't remember what it was, but the fellas wanted it to be played, and I think one of them might have gone up to him and asked, or they saw the sign, and so they said, "Gee, we'd like to hear that." So I said, "Well, I'll see what I can do." So I had an uncle of mine that had a ballroom up in Lake Winnipesaukee called the Winnipesaukee Gardens. And he was formerly a band leader himself, but then when he went into business up in the Weirs there, he ran this ballroom there. And one of the times when Glenn Gray and the Casaloma Orchestra back in the Depression days in the middle 30s there, they were on a hard time and they were having a little bit of difficulty getting booking. So I guess my uncle was sort of instrumental in helping him getting some bookings by giving him a booking at the Winnipesaukee Gardens for a period of time. So at least that's the way I understood the story. So anyway, I went up and I used that little wedge to go say, so-and-so and my uncle's Jimmy Owen from the Winnipesaukee Gardens. Oh, hey, how's Jim doing? Well, of course, I didn't know Jim that much, really. I'd only met him a couple of times. And I said, oh, he's fine. I said, yeah, what the fellow says, we just got back from overseas, and they'd like to hear this particular song. He said, well, I'll see what I can do for you. Okay, well, thank you very much. So sure enough, not too long after that, he played the song for them. So everybody said, gee, how'd you get to talk? I said, well, I haven't had, And of course, we had a very nice time. And there was another little thing that happened. Another thing that happened that night was I went out to go to the lavatory, and the maitre d' was out there, and he was talking to a priest, this Roman collar and everything. The priest sort of put his hand out and stopped me, and And so I asked him, want to know how I was. And I said, did you fellas just come back from? I said, yes, we just come back from convoy duty. And he said, so, well, good. And he asked me a couple other questions. And I went on my way. And when I came back, he was no longer there. The priest was no longer there. But the maitre d' came over to our table. You know, there was the whole 12 of us. We'd all had dinner and probably a couple of drinks and so forth. And he said, well, he said, fellas, I got some good news for you. He said, everything up to this point has been paid for by the Monsignor. So I don't know which Monsignor was, but he was very generous and had paid for everything up to that time. So there's a lot of good things like that happened.
You were talking about Les Brown's concert with Ella Fitzgerald. Was that the one you got kicked out of, or the one, you saw with Ella Fitzgerald, Les Brown band?
No, it wasn't with the Les Brown band. That was with Ella Fitzgerald was singing with the Chick Webb band.
Oh, Chick
That's
Webb
where
band.
She got a stand. Right. And Chick Webb band was the house band at Dance Hall in New York, the Savoy. Yeah, the Savoy. That was the house band. And he would play there on a regular basis, and then a lot of times they would have battles of bands, which they would bring another band in. And they brought in bands like Benny Goodman and other named bands that would play there and alternate back and forth. And Chick Webb would, and his band, they really make the other ones, outdo them, and they just play the same. It was an excellent band. Chick Webb was an excellent drummer. He was had a problem with his back, and I think he was sort of hunchbacked over, and I think he actually died very early, and then about 30, 35 years old. But Chick Webb sang for the band, and when he passed away, she fronted the band for a few years until she was able to get off on her own. So, any other?
Can you tell specifically about the time that you heard Chick Webb go up against Benny Goodman?
Oh, like, couldn't get in?
Wasn't there a time that Chick Webb went up against Benny Goodman
at
the Battle of the Bands?
Yeah, there was.
Can you tell us about that?
Well, I don't know anymore because I wasn't.
Oh, you weren't.
You were kicked out.
When I went to the Coast Guard, there was a little bit of delay after we joined them because they had where they wanted to send us was down to Manhattan Beach, which was in the lower end of Brooklyn on the waterfront. They were right close to the amusement park.
Where?
Coney Island. Yeah. Coney Island, right next to Coney Island. And we had bands. They had a band there at the base. And the band was under the direction of, I was thinking of him just the other day. I'll name him, but he was a well-known band leader at the time. He used to appear at the up in the Boston area there. I'd seen him before. And so, of course, when you first went there, you were in the quarantine, so you didn't get out for, 6 weeks, 7 weeks, or maybe even more, something like that. So they'd bring everything to you. So they would have a dance on the weekends in the gymnasium, and the Coast Guard band, but they were all professional musicians. And so then they would bring all the young ladies down there, and they would come and they would bring them in special buses in through the gates there, and so on. So like some of the things you'd see in the movies, the bus doors would open, all the young ladies would come charging out, and the fellas would be standing there. here they come. So I met this young lady over there, and I asked her for her phone number. She said, when they let me out free out of here, I'll come up to the city, can I see her? And so she very generous. She said, yes, I could. So I did that, and I called her up, and we went out. And she took me to a lot of very nice places there in the city that had dinner and dancing and so forth. But one of the things she warned me, don't go up to Harlem. That's not safe for you. So that was evidently she had some problem with it. So I took her advice. I never thought much about going up to Harlem, but I wish I had gone there. So I went to more of the other ballrooms in the city. And going to those bottoms there, you began to learn things. And when you sit down and you watch other folks dance, then you say, gee, that looks nice. I wonder if I could do that, try it. And I can remember going to a ballroom there somewhere off Times Square one night. And there was this chubby fellow there that was getting, all the girls would come up and ask him to dance. And I was watching him dance. And he had some great footwork and just moved around so nicely. I said, boy, I wish I could dance like that. You know? So I watched him. And I tried to do a lot of things like that afterwards. And I think I learned a lot when I was down in that area. There was always something going on in the area. After I got out of boot camp, I stayed right there in the area because I went to a school there. It was a motor machinist made school. And we stayed in a hotel up on Broadway and 70th Street, I think it was. So you didn't go out too much during the week, but you had the weekends off. So if you didn't catch the train to go home, you stayed in New York and then you went to all these different places. And there was a lot of things that went on that in the hotels, and they would have a band or they'd have somebody like a vocalist. There was a fellow by the name of Chuck Forster who was a very good vocalist, and he appeared one night in one of the hotels and was open to all the servicemen. So he would go there. So that was a lot of fun. So you'd learn, as I say, how to dance from there. So from there, they had trained all of us fellows for as far as much as they could, but they didn't have the ships ready for us. They didn't know what to do with us, and we were ready to graduate for, we were graduating for school, so they shipped us all out to St. Louis. They got us about as far as away from any water that they were able to, but that was fun out there because there was a couple of nice ballrooms out there. One was Toontown, which was on the edge of the Forest Park out there in the middle of St. Louis, and I had some good bands that came in there. It was a very, very popular place, so I would go there and dance. And they had another one, which I don't remember the name of it. It was another part of it. It was a smaller ballroom, but there was the two ballrooms there, so I would go there and dance. And I didn't seem to have any trouble, you know, getting dances and so forth, especially once it was determined it was that I was doing what they call the New York Lindy, or this was one girl described it. In fact, I remember going to a dance down in Galveston or someplace like that, but just below Houston somewhere. And it was a USO thing, I think. But there was a lot of guys, sailors in there, mostly sailors, and not too many young ladies. But I did get a chance to dance once. And after that, I didn't have any trouble getting a dance. And I found out the reason, because one of the girls said, I want to dance New York style. I said, oh, she says, oh, you're doing New York style. So then I said, oh, fine, I'm New York style Lindy Hop. So. Anyway.
So you went to dances in New York while you were off from duty, and you went to a lot of Boston area or Massachusetts area dances growing up.
Yeah.
Were there any dances you went to further north in New England? You only recently moved to New Hampshire, right?
Well, yeah. No, outside of New Hampshire, the only dances we went to before I was in the service, of course, was up at Hampton Beach. And of course, that was a big destination on Hampton Beach held a unique position amongst a lot of the mothers in the Boston area, because Hampton Beach, of course, was a dry town, and they seemed to be very strict in how they patrolled it. They had, at the start of the summer season, when the young fellows would get out of college, they would recruit them as temporary policemen, so that at the Hampton Beach at that time, they didn't allow any drunkenness or any rowdiness on the streets or anything. So it was a very, very safe place. So the mothers were very, very confident when their daughters would say, well, I'm going to go up with the girls and we're going to go to the Hampton Beach. So, of course, the mecca there for the dancing was with the Hampton Beach Casino. And go up to the Hampton Beach, the casino was on the upper floor. And there was a very, very wide set of stairs, and they were kind of steep. And you would start up those wide set of stairs. And up at the top of the wide set of stairs was a wide, tall state policeman. And it's just, you would be coming up those stairs, and you're looking up here, and there's this tall policeman. So you got the message that no fooling around allowed. So it was just a nice place to go for the kids. The beach wasn't that hot. I mean, it was, in fact, the water's extremely cold, but the dancing was very nice. We had a lot of fun up there. So all the fellas used to go on up there on the weekends.
Who did you see play up there? Who did you see play there?
Actually, I don't actually remember any of the bands that I played there. At that time, it was a New Hampshire band that was the house band there, and that was Ted Herbert out of Manchester. So he played there, but like a lot of the house bands, he had an excellent band, and at particular times, he would have some musicians playing for him that later on became well-known in other bands. There was another band down in South Shore, Massachusetts, that used to play down at the ballroom down there in Marshfield. It was called the Sea Breeze or something like that. And his name was Mal Hallett, and he had an excellent band, but he didn't want to travel. So that limited him his exposure. But he had some excellent musicians playing. He even had Gene Krupa play for him at one time before Gene became very, very famous. So same. So you'd see good musicians wherever you went. Sort of a note, the musicians back in those days were a lot of times were self-taught or had limited professional teachers. And so they learned a lot just by playing a lot and playing with other good musicians. But also, most high schools and most junior high schools had bands and orchestras, and a lot of times the music was taught by professional musicians who were very good, and they would be able to bring the students along and teach them quite a bit, even in those limited manner there, so that the young people in the schools would form bands. And I know Zach formed a band there, he told me one time. Well, they did that. There was maybe in high school when I was going, there might have been three or four bands in the high school. You know, you didn't always see them, but they would play for little fundraisers and so forth. Sometimes they were pretty good. Or they might have one fellow in the band, he'd carry the whole thing. You know, he'd be the only one to really know how to play anything, but he'd carry the whole thing. Plus, you'd all be very, very exuberant anyway. You wanted to go dancing. You wanted to dance with your girlfriend. And it didn't necessarily mean swing all the time, because ballroom dancing, you did waltzes and foxtrot. Foxtrots were very popular, Latin, but usually just rumbas. And that was all very popular. And, so where are we now?
Go ahead.
Would you say?
Do you want to go walk around, or are you going to stiff in that chair? I know that's not a comfortable chair.
Oh,
so,
sure?
Okay.
Should I tell you just about the one going to see Glenn Miller?
Well, I was actually wondering, and get your question in too, if you went to your uncle's ballroom. You said he had a ballroom on Lake Winnipesaukee, and what that
I
was.
Did, yes. And my uncle had the ballroom operated maybe, most ballrooms I operated probably five nights a week, but maybe his, maybe because the season was short, probably he might have operated to six or seven nights a week. And they had the usual the house band, and then they would, on weekends, would be the traveling bands come in, the name bands. And I think I remember Freddie Martin going in there when I was up there. And I was only, it was either one or two summers that I spent up there, with the whole family went up, we had a cottage. And I get kind of bored doing a lot of just swimming and all that kind of stuff. So I went and worked for my uncle, and I used to gas up the boats. So it was a lot of fun doing that. And the year that I remember, they had the jukebox going there, and the popular song at that time was Song of India with the Tommy Dorsey Orchestra. And the people used to come in, and that's all I would hear all day long was the Song of India. But I never got tired of it, because it was so much fun, you know. And So I wasn't that much of a dancer back there. That's what I'm talking now. What's between either 36 to 38 in that area. I do remember going to a, in fact, I got pictures of going to a masquerade ball there on at the bar, all dressed up in a, and I, King George period time there and the powdered wig and the whole bit there going at that, my sister going there. In fact, my sister and I went together and she got the, she got, you know, she, and my sister went with my youngest sister. And my older sister and she, they got the best couple until they realized that she wasn't a guy. She looked, that was funny.
Would you say that you've danced to all of the major bands other than Artie Shaw?
A good many of them, I can't say. I mean, there'd be people come up and say, well, did you ever dance, actually dance to this guy, that guy? No. But the ones that I danced to, that we danced to at a formal one night, it was a hospital charity, to Count Basie band. And being in a formal, you know, get up there with the tux and all that jazz, we still were able to dance, and it was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun watching him. That was towards the end of his career, so he wasn't really as active then. He played at the piano, and I think maybe the second set or something he didn't play, and then he came back for the third set, you know. So he was kind of taking it easy at that time. But yeah, I danced him, as I said, Tommy Dorsey and Vaughn Monroe, and then, of course, we danced to Glenn Miller Orchestra. That was... Did you say you wanted to hear that again? Well, when I went double dating, I had the car. I had bought a car that was just 1942 before I was ready to go into service, still having my last fling there. And as I say, my summer of 42, you might remember there's a movie in summer of 42. My summer of 42, this was probably the high spot of it. And I had a good friend of mine who was another redhead, and had a nice personality, a little naive, but a great fellow. And he and I oftentimes got together and we'd go off and enjoy dancing with the girls and going up the totem pole and so forth, and all in double dates and triple dates and so forth, and just have a lot of fun, the whole bunch of us. So his girlfriend saw that, I noticed that the Glenn Miller band would be up at a ballroom called Sun Valley, which was located in Shrewsbury, Mass. And it was basically an open-air ballroom. I think they had a small indoor portion, but it was basically an open-air ballroom. So she wanted, would like to go to the dance. I had the car. She was, gee, can you get a date? I said, I don't know. All my current girlfriends are either mad at me or going with somebody else. So he said, well, I get your date with Gloria's, which is his girlfriend, I get it with her friend. So, fine, I went with her friend, and we went off in my 34 Chevrolet, I guess it was, and we went off up to Shrewsbury to see the Glenn Miller Orchestra. And that was really a night to remember. The Glenn Miller Orchestra, of course, you're all familiar with him. His orchestra playing on the radio, in the movies. He played some excellent movies. And so you felt like that you really knew the orchestra. It was a joy to dance to him. But the thing was that when he'd put on the show, and they usually had the show numbers that would feature the Mordenaires and Ray Eberly and Tex Beneke. And you'd had seen them in the movies, you'd heard them on the record, but to see them in person and to see their personalities really shown, and that's the thing that I remember the most about the Glenn Miller Orchestra. Wasn't just In the Mood or Pennsylvania 6500, things like that. It was those vocal numbers that really brought out the personality of the Glenn Miller Orchestra when he appeared in person. And of course, that band, those nights, when you'd go to a band like that and see a band like that that was very entertaining, the people would stop dancing and they would crowd in front of the stage, and it might be 10, 12 rows or more deep there at the front of the stage listening to the band and really close up to it. In fact, well, no, that was the way. But anyway, that was the night. And as far as myself, I could always reminisce about that, but it was just me that could reminisce about it. I didn't have anybody to say, gee, do you remember the night we went to see the Glen Villa? Because I wasn't really a friend of the girl that I went with. It was just sort of accommodation. She was nice enough to go with me, and I was nice enough to take her, so it worked out very nicely. Roger went off in the army, and he never made it back from Normandy, and I never saw his girlfriend again, and so I didn't have those people to talk to until one night that I went to see Dom V over in Watertown, and this woman was doing the refreshments, and I found out that it was Dom V's mother, and I talked with her. After a while, I sort of gave it a shot. I said, do you live in the Worcester area and grow up? She said, oh, yes, I grew up there. So I said, by any chance, I said, oh, I remember going and seeing Glen Miller. She said, I was there. So there, I had last found someone who I could share my experience with and talk about it. So that, to me, that was really nice. I said, wow, at last somebody else was there. It wasn't just a figment of my imagination. That was it on Glen Miller. Next question.
When did you move up to New Hampshire? How long have you
moved to New Hampshire? 84, I guess, was the first house, but that was only
a weekend.
No, well, we actually permanently moved to New Hampshire in 86, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How long have you lived up in Lincoln now?
This winter was 5 years. We moved there in 2000. Okay. So we're on our sixth year now.
Mm. So how much do you dance these days?
Well, now these days, actually, we almost dance more than we ever did, because we try to make a dance most every weekend. Now, if it isn't someplace that we have to travel to, like traveling over here to the Newport Opera House, we might say to look at one another and say, let's go up to the Beacon or let's go up to the Indian Head. And these are both motels and resorts right there in Lincoln, and they have, one has a place as a lounge that they have dancing in, and the other has what they call Dad's Nightclub, and they have dancing there. Sometimes it's kind of difficult to dance because of the numbers they play, and other times because they might have entertainment there, which would be vocalists or ventriloquists or comedians or something like that. So you might spend 2 or 3 hours there and not really get that much chance to dance. But still, it's better than not dancing. Plus, we also have in our playroom down cellar, I have an 11 by 11 parquet floor that we put in there and a reasonably good sound system with speakers set around there. And we use that for our exercises. We have a walking machine down there and we do the stretching and so forth. Plus we dance a little bit. And it's a lot of fun because you can try out a few things and just sometimes when you just put on a record or a tape and just something real good. Barbara might be upstairs doing something in the kitchen, but pretty soon down she comes. We do a couple of numbers of dance, and then she goes back upstairs, and I maybe finish my exercises or stretching. But we do dance quite a bit. It's part of our exercise program. It's an exceptionally good exercise program. You oftentimes see where they'll compare calories burned and so forth, and they'll put dancing at one of the higher slots as far as burning calories in the length of time that you dance. So, yeah, we dance quite a bit. And we travel. We travel up to 125 miles or more. And we had the motorhome there for quite a number of years, and we used to use that. And so it was no problem having a place to stay. And a lot of the dance places that we went to, such as over to Maplewood over in Portland there, the fellow was very generous, and he said, oh, no problem, park right alongside the building. Just stay there as long as you want. So we would do that. go there and park there, get ready, walk out of the motorhome, walk around the corner, and be at the dance hall, dance, and then come back, stay there for the night. So we did the same thing. We used to go up to Burlington, Vermont, and the same thing there. We could stay there at the schoolyard. They used to, they held the dances in the South Burlington Junior, South Burlington Junior High School. So what else can we talk about?
Okay, I'm out of tape. Just about. You like stopped it just perfect.
Okay.
I don't know what's on the beginning of this tape, but it's going to be Aussie for the rest of it.
It's not one of our other movies, is it?
I don't know. It doesn't matter. There's time left on it. I'm not recording over anything.
Oh, okay. So tell us about this competition you won.
Well, actually, Barbara and I never made much of a habit of getting into competitions. We kind of didn't like it. Actually, Barbara's very, very shy. She will not, very, very seldom, ever take the floor when there isn't anybody else dancing there. Once in a while, or occasionally, when the number is just too good, she will. That occasion was one time the compact big band started off. We were at a dance in West Boylston, Mass. And they started out with Jumping at the Woodside. And it was so good, she almost pulled my arm off to get me up out of the table. I said, Bob, there isn't anybody dancing. Out on the floor we went. But that's the only time. Other than that, she just doesn't want to get up somebody else. And we've sat glued to our seats while some real nice numbers might be played. But there isn't anybody else at the dance floor. And I might fool her once in a while. I said, oh, those people are getting up over there. They're going to dance. So let's go. And she'd get up. And she'd say, oh, no, you're doing a number. But, yeah, that's one reason why we never entered a dance contest. Bob was a little giant. I was controlling the ham and me, so we never did that. But we did get to this dance over in Northfield, and I was at the Norwich Academy or Norwich University. And at some point during the well, the theme of the dance was the 1940s music, and there was also costumes, if you could wear a costume, anything that would be what folks were wearing back in those days, please do, and so a lot of folks did. There was one fellow that appeared there in a zoot suit, which, well, it was all right, there were zoot suits in those days, but they were the little bit of the odd ones there, but anyway, they held a dance contest, so they got the folks up on the floor, and Barbara and I, of course, didn't make any attempt to get up, but some of those at the table, and I think actually John came over and said, come on, you folks, you've got to get up and dance. So we got up and we danced. So it was one of these applaud when they held the hand over your head. And we kept getting some very, very loud applause. So I kept looking at Barbara. I said, these kids are very nice. I said, they're looking at us and they're saying, well, gee, they're the oldest couple on the floor. We'll give them a break or something like that, you know. So anyway, we won the dance contest. There were several people involved in it and some good dances there. But with our famous dancing, we got to we won the prize. So I said, well, that's good. I'll probably get a choice of another book or something, which I had won a book a little earlier in some kind of a drawing that they had. So lo and behold, they gave us an envelope, and in the envelope was $50. I said, wow, so that's really great. So then we also had the honor that evening of picking out what the best costume. And of course, we very, very quickly said no to the zoot suiters. And we did pick with one other young lady who was dressed very much as the folks did back in those days, especially the shoes that she wore. Barbara had noticed that and said that the shoes seemed to be very, very authentic. And so that was nice. It was a very, very nice evening.
What was the song you danced to for the competition? Do you remember what song it was that you danced to?
It went on several different swing numbers that John, but they were numbers that were popular back in the World War II era. And that type of affair has gone on several times, and they keep doing it now. They have what they call a 1942. USO canteen show, and they will have people in uniform trying, but seeing like the Andrews sisters or some of the other folks that were back in those days and playing those songs. We went to a show like that down at the North Shore Music Theater, and it was the what they call the Winter Sauce Chorus there, which was a famous choral group in the Boston area, and they put on a show like that, and they were very good playing the old songs that came out during that period. And the band that night was, as I call it, the Reconstituted Artie Shaw Band, led by Dick Johnson. And when they started to play Frenesy or one of those songs that Artie Shaw had made quite popular, but they were playing it over the PA system, a recording of it, and the band was there, and the stage lights were down very, very low. And pretty soon, you realized that it was no longer the recording, it was the band playing. It was a seamless introduction from the recorded number to the band actually playing, and then they did an excellent job of on the Artie Shaw numbers with Dick Johnson playing, who, by the way, was picked by Artie Shaw to lead the band. What else? Where were we?
What is the biggest change, do you think, between the dances you used to go to and the dancing that you do now?
Well, the dances we used to go to, for the most part, if you went to the ballrooms, there was a lot more ballroom dancing. And in fact, some ballrooms, there would be a wall chart, and the wall chart would give the order of dances. And the order of dances would be usually, it'd start out with a Latin number and a foxtrot number, and then it would be a waltz, and then it might be another foxtrot, or they might even put swing down there. And then usually the last one on the list would be a polka. So then the next set would go pretty much the same way. They'd play that. And then maybe later on during the night, the band leader, maybe after looking at his audience and seeing what they liked the most, he might just more or less play a lot more swing numbers and so forth. But there was a good, what's the word I want? A number of different dances there. There's no word I want, but anyway. And of course, after all, if you took a nice young lady to dance, you didn't want to always have her at arm's length. You certainly want to have her in your arms, because that was a big part of going out with the young lady. At least you get a chance to hold her once in a while if you went dancing with her, you know. But anyhow, that's what would happen. That was the big thing. Nowadays, you'll go to a dance, or you go to Swing City. I don't think they've ever played a waltz at Swing City that I know of. I did go, remember going to down at Boston Swing Dance, and Peter Davis Band was down there. And he played his usual smooth swing numbers. And I don't know if he played any Latin or them, but at the end of the evening, somebody asked him to play a waltz. And he played the nicest waltz there, just as, sort of with the clarinet. He has sort of an airy thing. Not eerie, but airy, sort of light. And we just danced around there and did that waltz, and there were so many other people that enjoyed it. But everything else other than that was swing. And I think I mentioned that to somebody that wanted to go down there one night. He says, you know, they don't play anything else but swing numbers. And in fact, we had met a couple one night when we went to a dance that had that was by the Fantasy Big Band that's out of Hopedale, Mass area, Hopedale, Milford. And he plays all the old big band numbers, but he plays some good swing, but he plays the waltzes and he plays the foxtrots and so forth. And this couple we met, they were just really learning how to dance, and the fellow was kind of, well, he was pretty good. He was trying real hard, but he had a lot of trouble with the swing numbers, and he did a little better at the foxtrot numbers. And so we saw him again another night that the band was playing somewhere, and the same band, and enjoyed talking to him. So one night we met him down at Swing City. He was with a different young lady at the time, and they would get up and he was doing a little better on his swing dancing, all that he didn't really quite look like Frankenstein. That was pretty much the way he was dancing before, because he didn't have any fluid movement. But he was doing a lot better. But a little later on, he came over and spoke. Well, after we had said hello to one another, a little later on, he came over and said, "Gee," he says, "I know the band is good, but," he says, "don't they play anything else but swing?" And I said, "No, they don't." And that happened to be the White Heat Swing Orchestra. Craig Ball, I don't know if you folks have heard him yet. If you ever want to hear something that is very, very close to what Benny Goodman was like when he was just playing swing. Now, a lot of the Benny Goodman orchestra numbers later on, after 39 or so, 40 at the place, a lot of those was an entirely different band. The arrangements were different. He played a lot of foxtrots, a lot of slower music. He wasn't the swing band that he was back in the 36, 38 years. And this Craig Ball is the same way. Barbara and I went down there, and there was a lot of numbers we just couldn't dance to. Couldn't even do the Balboa to him. It was just so uncomfortable trying to do it. But everybody down there had the greatest time. And this is probably one of the first times since the days of the big band that I ever heard the audience, after the orchestra stopped, that they let out a collective gasp and hooray type of thing. And they did it that night several times to Craig Ball and his swing band. And they really were a swing band. And my ear picked that up right away. Thank God I hadn't heard that. Because some of those theater dates that Benny Goodman had, you know, of course, the kids get up and dance in the aisles. I mean, that wasn't some made-up story. I'd actually seen them get out and dance in the aisles. Not only here in the Boston area, but one time I saw them down in New York. They did the same thing. Benny Goodman would stand there and turn around, and he'd have that bemused look on his face that he would have, and looking at these kids and as if to say, "Oh, why are they doing that?" And he, of course, all the time he knew why they were doing it. The band was sending them. But yeah, they do.
How many years have you and Barbara been dancing together?
Well, now it's 60 years. As I say, we danced the first thing actually I said to her, "Would you care to dance?" Whatever way I said it, I don't know if you'll quite remember it.
I'd like to put this under your hand. What's your favorite style of swing to do? You've mentioned New York Lindy was popular, and you mentioned you do a lot of Balboa. What do you like to do?
Well, we like to do, actually, is our favorite song. It's our favorite type of music. I'll get around to what you're answering your question. Our favorite type of dance is the swing dance. And it's our version of whatever you want to call it, East Coast swing or Lindy. I sort of call it just plain Lindy, because I pretty much think that's what we try to do. Although, to really get down there and pinpoint it, it's just very, very difficult to say it's a particular style other than a Lindy. Some people might look at it and say, "Well, gee, that doesn't look like the East Coast that we do over at so-and-so. It doesn't look like the East Coast we do down in Florida," which... how many times we go dancing? We went down to Florida, in 11 days we danced 7 different times. I'm afraid I'm going to knock that thing out. We danced, so when you ask how often we dance, you know, we dance as often as we can. I guess that would have to be the answer. So if we didn't dance here tonight, we probably would have gone up to one of the Indian Head or the other place there, the Dad's Nightclub. Going out somewhere, because a lot of times we look at one another and say, "Why should we be sitting here? We could be dancing." So off we do. And then I use the internet, and I find out all the different places that are holding the dances, and I make out a little log for the whole month. And I have Friday, Saturday, and Sunday on that, and I put down what the dances are. So when we get somewhere during the middle of the week, we'll say, "Well, where should we try to go this weekend?" So depending upon other things that might come up, as far as someone coming up to see us or whether we're feeling quite up to it or not, we'll select where we want to go. And Now, of course, without the motorhome, I usually make a reservation at some hotel, which I'm a very popular person with a lot of the hotel companies now. And I book online, and we go to the dance, and stay overnight at the hotel, and come back and just enjoy it. And so there are the different places that we can go, Swing City, Boston Swing Dance, go up to Norwich and see John. We can go down dance to Swing on Sunday. He had some very good bands down there. So we try to do that. And we really like to go where they have live music. And if it's a big band, that's even better. And so I hope sometime that you folks can come and see the Compact Big Band if you haven't already seen them. Now, I think they're going to appear down Swing City this month, I think.
Oh, this week?
This month, if not March, it's April, one of the two.
You tell us who you're going to see tonight?
Well, now we're going to see a band that, I don't know how many years we've been watching them, but 4 or 5 years now, probably first time we saw them, 4 or 5 years ago, the Moonlighters. And they're a community band. A community band, by that I mean most of the people that get that are playing the band live fairly close to Windsor, Vermont. I think that's where they're from. And they're all musicians that have had fairly good amount of training, and they enjoy big band music. And from the time that we first heard them until the last time that we were dance that we went to, and I'm trying to think of when we heard them. Where was that the last time?
Recently.
This year, you know, the Moonlighters. Wherever it was, anyway. Was it here that we saw them? Yeah. All right. They've really improved. They're doing a lot of the numbers really good. And I really appreciate that. And I often tell, I don't know, I know I spoke to the young lady that plays the saxophone and seems to be the leader. Well, I spoke to her one time and told her, tried to tell her how appreciative we were of the fact that they were playing that music. And I know they have to go through a lot, and they put a lot of their own, not only their efforts in it, but their own money into it to get instrumentation they might need, microphones they might need, and also charts that they have to buy and pay for. And so I'm very, very appreciative of that. And in fact, as I say, the differences in dancing today, I think someone that's playing the big band type music will bring back a lot of ballroom dancing. And then and folks will say, they are the ones that will play the type of music that we can ballroom dance to. It's kind of been a little bit of a resurgence now, especially with the Dancing with the Stars has become so popular, and a couple of other dance programs. And I can see the advertising now that's done by the Arthur Murray Studios. They name that Dancing with the Stars. They say, so learn to dance like one of the stars. So it's really showing a little bit of resurgence, and I hope that some of these community bands and some of the bands like Dom V and Fantasy Big Band, and there's another one down in Bedford, New Hampshire, called the Bedford Big Band. They're excellent. They're very, very good. In fact, they have put on one of the better shows emulating the Glenn Miller Orchestra's Maud Nevers. They have a group of singers from the band and two women that do the vocalists there. Excellent. They do a great job. It was really nice listening to them.
What would you say the biggest change has been in the music when you saw the original big bands? How has the music changed now?
It's in the arrangements. And there's not too many big bands that just played big band charts that were arranged years ago. There's not too many. I mean, there are some that will play the more popular ones and play them pretty much note for note. Most of the bands, depending upon the players that they have and the expertise of the players, will arrange the so-called standards, the numbers that they played back in those days, will arrange those standards for their own orchestra. And they will have different endings. That's the one thing, the one big thing. They have the different endings. The endings will be a lot more flourishing and so forth. Whereas in big band, depending upon how many notes they had in the first bar, they play the notes that they left out in the first bar. They play that in the second bar, so the last bar, and sometimes the music will be go da da da, and it'll just stop just like that. Whereas big bands today, they go da 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 da, and they make a big flourish.
How has the dancing style changed?
The dancing style, to me, and then now I have to speak for myself, because when you go back to the beginnings of swing dancing, it still was kind of wild. Especially that swing dancing you'd see in the movies, and they were really fast and wild. In fact, there's a movie I'll call now Swing Kids that came out maybe 2-3 years ago. I don't think it ever became terribly popular, but we have a copy of it there. And it shows in the scenes in that where they do the swing dancing, is it's the very fast, physical, what do they call them now?
Aerials,
yeah. A lot of aerials in it. And of course, the places where I grew up, there was still the strong ballroom dancing there. That was the lead thing. And so the swing dancing wasn't anything wild. It was a lot smoother and quiet. So I really got into the smooth swing dancing. And even down at the down in New York and places when I was in the service, there was a lot more smoother swing dancing, although there was still a lot of aerials going on, which you had to be very careful of. But anyway, the smoother style swing dancing was what I was used to and what I saw a lot of. Now, the swing dancing, for the most part, isn't quite as smooth. I think a lot of that has to do with the so-called West Coast style, which is, to me, isn't quite as smooth. And the dancers, even though it's partners, and which is a partner dance, the partners sometimes are doing their own thing. They're really not dancing together. The lead may be doing nothing more than just turning 180 degrees this way, and his partner's out there, and she's doing the steps and so forth, or doing something that she likes, and then come back on the other side and turn 180 degrees. And he really hasn't done much but just act as an anchor for the young lady who's doing all the dancing. Whereas when Barbara and I dance, we do a lot of steps in synchronization. She's doing pretty much the same step on a shadow or a negative, just the opposite of what I'm doing, but it's together we're dancing. And so that's, and it becomes a lot more smoother. A lot of the dancing, as I say, there again, talking about the smoothness, a lot of the movements are rather jerky and it's just, but then the music isn't just the same either. A lot of the rhythm is not the smoother swing dance rhythm that I was used to. But you got to remember, of course, I wasn't brought up in the city like Barbara was. I was brought up in the suburbs. And the people a little bit more gentler, there weren't quite as many wild people. Yeah.
Can you describe for me, Ozzy, one of your favorite moves to do?
One of the favorite moves? Well, we do one now, Barbara and I, that involves actually there's two, but we do one that involves dancing See, the trouble is this dancing comes to us a lot in the way the music is played. And the moves that you do, sometimes you won't do the same move again that you've done tonight, or you may not do it again two months later. And then all of a sudden, because of the way the music is playing, the rhythms is playing, you will start doing a particular move. But to get back to a particular move, there's two of them that I like. And the one is, whereas I said, Barbara's left hand on my hand here, and then she starts a turn, goes around, and she brings her hand all the way around, and then I get her on the other side, and then we begin. That's kind of nice. Or sometimes when she's out this, now we're doing it this way, when she's gone all the way around here, and then I have a hold of her hand at this point, then we'll stop and do just a freeze motion for a beat or two. And that turns out kind of nice. And then the other one is when we do the, how do we get into the jig now? We do a couple of turns, and then I bring her in and we do the jig, which is what I understand, and we kick forward, but we're holding one another close together. And I think I kick one leg through between her legs and so forth, and do that a couple of times. And then she puts her right arm behind her, and I take that and I give her a fast spin there, and she comes out and then brings her back underneath my arm, and then she scoots back this way, and that can work out very nicely. And then sometimes it's followed by the dancing this way. I will take her right hand and throw it back this way, and then that is a signal to her that she turns around to her right and back, then goes in back of me, and then she trails her left hand around my waist, and then I grasp her left hand when she comes back over this side. And then sometimes that's it, or sometimes we just do a couple of turns. So those are a couple of my favorites. But actually, though, the whole darn thing is my favorite, you know. If you have to pick out something, that's what I like.
Has the reason you like to dance, the reason you dance, changed at all from when you danced in the 40s to why you dance now?
No. It's great enjoyment. I always had a smile on my face, and I still do when we dance. And it's just so much fun. And a lot of people enjoy watching. We're well-known amongst our friends for being a dancer. We've been called everything from smoothies to whatever. We were involved quite heavily in sponsoring drum and bugle corps, and sometimes we would have dances, and the kids would come to the dances, and they'd just stand there, and they'd say, stand there. We'd say to them, well, gee, we didn't see you folks out there dancing. And they'd say, oh, gee, who's going to get out there and dance when you two are out there? We can't dance. Things like that, you know. They always ask us, so you're still dancing, you know? And still dancing. So we do. We really enjoy it.
If you woke up tomorrow and couldn't dance for some reason, what would you miss the most about it?
What would I miss the most about it? It's just the companionship. I mean, you're doing something. So it's very, very, dancing is very, very sociable, which is one thing I like about going to the dances now, is that the manner in which they're conducted, especially with the so-called lesson beforehand, which most of the people in dancing have done that lesson many, many a time. But it gives them an opportunity to meet the other folks. And it's very nice because it's sort of a given. It's a given that you're at the dance, you're here to dance. People are going to ask you to dance even if you haven't been introduced to them. And you want to dance, so you should accept. So I have very seldom seen anybody ever refuse, and I'm always delighted when somebody comes over and asks me, and I get a big kick out of it. And then when Zachary first asked Barbara to dance, I mean, we used to wow our friends and say, well, Barbara danced with it. Zachary was only 18 at the time. I said, she's danced with an 18-year-old old boy. So they'd say, wow. And I would say, well, of course, he comes and says, Barbara, can I borrow the body for a few spins or something like that? I forgot just what the word. So it's that relaxed atmosphere where a lot of times at dancing, year before, a lot of the girls would not dance with anybody who came up unless they knew them. Or and sometimes even if they knew them, they wouldn't dance with them. Probably more reason not to dance with them. So that was always kind of difficult. So that was always something that entered your mind. You said, well, gee, I'll go up and ask that girl to dance. What if she says, no, I'm going to feel like a dummy, you know? And the worst thing in the world is if, of course, this breaking in, I never really cared for that, but I mean, still we used to do it. The worst thing in the world is to go out and try to break in and they wouldn't let you break in. You're in the middle of the dance floor. But those things happen. Well, that's one thing I like about the dancing. The other thing, it's very informal, and everybody can get out down there. They don't have to wear their best clothes. A lot of people, like Zachary, can just change his T-shirt some point during the dance, during the night. And then there's the fellow that I spoke about earlier there. He perspires quite a bit. He usually has two or three changes. And the other thing is most people don't mind if they got a towel stuck in their back pocket. That happens to many. So that's real nice about that part about it. Real nice.
I've done all of my questions.
Good.
Is there anything that you think we've missed, Ozzy?
No,
else?
But I just hope that folks would realize why big bands became so popular at that time. And they just filled a need, the big band. Actually, the actual big band era, when it became real popular, only lasted a few short years. But it certainly has the effects and the influence of that has lasted many, many years. It lasted over 60, 70 years, actually, from the time those bands first started. And still play them now. Actually, there's a very popular radio program, Music of Your Life, and they still play some of the big old band music. Oh, that's
between,
it. I'm through.
Between the time when you were dancing to the big bands in the 40s and when the revival came in the 90s, what did you dance to? Was there swing music being played? What kind of music did you dance to? Where did you go dancing?
Well, you danced. We went dancing at a lot of church dances. There were quite a number of church dances. In fact, we had a regular group of social group that we went out with that went dancing to church affairs, charity affairs, fundraisers. Going back, mentioning about Barbara and I being involved with Drum and Bugle Corps, now that lasted probably 15 years or so. And a lot of our fundraisers at the early part of that, we used to have dances. We would sponsor dances as fundraisers. And we would have various small bands, never big bands, that would come in. And they would play ballroom dance music. And that was where our dancing came from. And our brother, that's how we got our dancing in those days. And then whenever some big band affair came along, we would go to that. But that was, for the most part, we stayed pretty close to home at that period of time.
Was it harder to find places to dance during that period?
Was what?
Was it harder to find places
oh,
to
yes.
dance?
Oh, yes. Yeah, it was much harder. But we did find one place in the 80s, maybe before that. There was a place called the Danversport Yacht Club. And they used to have a dinner dance once a month there. And they had a full 18-piece band there. One was a fellow there out of Peabody, Mass., who was an instructor in one of the schools. And he had a full-time band that he played for engagements in that area. And he had some excellent musicians. A lot of his musicians came out of the Berklee School of Music in Boston. Also up there, there was Ted Herbert got back up in there, and he had an excellent band. And so we would go there, and that lasted for, I don't know quite how many years that lasted, but well, probably over 8 or 9 years, and we would go there several times a year. So I think it's going to get kind of noisy.